My story is quite different than the ones presented before. The Horta Museum has not a collection of objects to show, as the building itself, in the extraordinary Art Nouveau style, is the museum. Our challenge 20 years ago was to restore the former house and architectural office to its original glory in order to let the visitors discover Horta's way of living and how the initial design concept responded to the double program of living and working together. Therefore, I will explain you how we prepared and how we realized the restoration of this museum. Victor Horta, it was the slide before, you saw him, lived and worked in Brussels. The picture you saw was a picture, one of the rare pictures of Horta in his office. In 1898, he built his house and architectural studio in the 19th century neighborhood of Saint-Gilles municipality. He designed them as two independent buildings with separate entrances, yet connected on the ground and second floor, as you can see on the drawings. On your left is the house, on your right is the office. The facades display clearly the different functions. This can be seen, for example, in the bow window and balcony, the components of the traditional townhouse, and in the large windows of the second floor draftsman studio, and in the single window frame that provides light to the employees' ground floor offices and the sculpture basement workshop. During his 20 years of occupation, Horta himself had enlarged his home and sculpture workshop at the garden site and even transformed his office on the ground floor at the street into a garage, as you can see on the middle drawing. On your left, you have the original picture, and in the middle, the transformation that Horta himself made. In 1919, he sold both buildings to two different owners. One of them bought the house and kept it as it was. The other one remodeled the studio to adapt it to its new function as a home. In the 70s, the house and studio were purchased by the Saint-Gilles municipality, and after 50 years of separation, the two buildings were reunited and furnished as a monographic museum. In 1963, they were the first Art Nouveau buildings to be protected as historic monument in Belgium, and in 2000, inscribed on the UNESCO World Heritage List as one of the four major townhouses of Victor Horta. Finally, in 1989, my team was commissioned to provide a global plan for restoration and rehabilitation of the complex as a house museum, in order to let the visitor discover Horta's way of living, responding on his double living and working program. Firstly, a rough maintenance and restoration campaign of the whole building complex was urgently required. Secondly, because of the growing number of visitors, more than 50,000 per year, new demands on the level of accommodation and security arose, and the current standards had to be fulfilled. At last, the objective to refurbish the building into a house museum demanded to conserve or even were needed to reconstruct the home and studio into their original state as regards to the volume as well as to the interior decoration. An additional request was that the museum should keep its function during the execution of the works and that the accessibility for the visitors should be maintained. Today, the former house and studio are a museum house, where the living spaces and the architectural office are accessible for the public, providing all the visitors accommodation which was needed. It is also a study center for research on Art Nouveau, with a selective library and Horta's personal archives. And finally, it has a small exposition area in the cellars where the plaster models are represented in the former sculpture workshop. Recently, this space is also occupied by the museum children's atelier, where the children learn about Art Nouveau style and architecture. And the museum houses also the office of the Art Nouveau Network. The internal layout is organized around three stairwells, one in red on the plans, in the family home, offering multiple perspectives towards the living spaces. A second one, in green on the plan, is a separate staircase for the domestic staff, and a third one in blue for the employees of the architect's studio. The ultimate goal was for Horta's ultimate goal was, as he wrote in his memoirs, to create a personal oeuvre in which social, architectural, and structural rationalism were combined. He conceived his house and studio as a total work of art. Characteristic is the innovative plan layout, the fluidity of the spaces, and the visual interrelation between spaces and levels, as well as the open stair construction crowned by a stained glass dome, which allows light to enter right into the heart of the home. Those heritage values are clearly expressed by this picture, taken from the Grand Salon at the street side, towards the dining room and the winter garden at the garden side. Moreover, Horta's audaciously combined industrial and luxury materials, blending them with the craftsman's skill. In the dining room that you see here, the use of steel in construction and decoration is combined with glazed brick and various marbles and woods. I'll show you a few other pictures of the staircase with, on top, the beautiful stained glass dome. Our research into the building's history was undertaken in collaboration with Françoise Aubry, prominent art historian and since almost 30 years curator of the museum. It enabled the chronology of construction to be understood and to determine the building's period of splendor from an architectural and historical viewpoint. For this, it was necessary to fully measure the house, the studio, and the garden, and to compare Horta's original plans with more recent ones. The plans shown are the set the architect drew to obtain the building permit and show the original state of the buildings. They are very precious to us because Horta destroyed himself at the age of 75 most of his archives, and not a lot of original plans are left. Thus, it could be established that in 1906, Horta himself had enlarged the house with a sitting room overlooking the garden, a dressing room at the first floor, and a terrace and conservatory at the top floor. Furthermore, 2 years later, he enlarged the surface area of the sculpture workshop with an additional basement by installing a skylight in the garden. Finally, in 1911, he once again reformed the workshop to include a garage by opening up part of the front facade. Of this latter innovation, a photographic record remains, even though documents of 1920 show that it existed. And then, after the buildings were sold to different owners, especially the studio suffered from considerable transformations, as you can see on the plans. The result of the research was assembled on the synthesis plans of the building history, demonstrating clearly which part of the building faces were still preserved in 1989. This information turned out to be crucial in the decision-making process of the conservation project. The same has been done on other plans as sections, etc. It was decided that the addition of the garage had spoiled the composition of the original facade, while the 1906 and 1908 reforms were an extension of the original project and conserved the harmony of the whole. Therefore, the historical study and the value assessment determined that the heyday of Horta's house and studio complex should be situated between 1908 and 1911, after the various enlargement on the garden site, yet before the addition of the garage. This was the period set as historic frame of reference in the master plan of the restoration. As a result, all transformations carried out after 1911 were decided to be dismantled. Then the master plan defined the spaces with high heritage value, particularly the entire family home and the studios, first and second floors, as the house museum. Other functions, such as accommodation spaces for the visitors, Horta's personal archives, the library and office rooms, the housekeeper's apartment, were housed in zones that had already been reformed or had little architectural value. Six restoration campaigns were organized over a span of 20 years. We started with the restoration of the back facade, the reconstruction of the volume of the sculpture workshop and the renovation of the interior visitors area. Then the front facades were restored. Thirdly, the main stairwell was reinforced after some stability problems had occurred. And for 10 years, the interior decoration of the museum spaces were restored. And after the housekeeper had left, the last phase of restoration started in the former kitchen and the surface staircase. It is impossible to mention, it's important to mention that every restoration campaign was preceded by the dismantlement of the modifications after 9/11. There is no time to explain in detail each phase, of course, of the restoration, so I will give a short chronological overview of the works. As soon as we removed to the first phase, as soon as we removed all those modifications of the 1911, the original volume, the sculpture workshop, and the studio's garden site was rebuilt, and the garden facades and roofs were restored. Then the ground floor and cellar of the studio were furnished into the visitors' reception with a cloakroom, museum shop, sanitary facilities, and exhibition spaces. During a third campaign, the restoration of the facades intended mainly to repair the initial situation of the studio, the large windows of the draftsman's workshop, the single window frame on the ground floor, office and the sculpture basement atelier, as well as the iron fence in front that was reconstructed. Furthermore, all the ironworks on both facades were repainted in ochre color, as it was the oldest layer paint that was revealed. Concerning the reconstruction of the window frame of the ground floor, it is important to mention that a detailed study of Horta's 1898 plans and an old photo from the museum archives enabled us to establish the original composition of the large window, as well as to define the drawing of the extremely complex fence in ironwork. The creation of this window, along with its corresponding railing, was the result of a closely collaboration between excellent craftsmen. I'll show you a few other details. And the final. At a certain moment, diverse structural problems had been identified on the main staircase of the house, mainly due to the overload of the more than 50,000 visitors per year. Therefore, a fourth campaign consolidated the interior structure of the eight landings and timber joints of the stair stringers in an invisible manner, using metal plates glued to the timber stringers and reinforced by stainless steel pins. This restoration phase made it clear that the museum's very success had disastrous consequences for the building and resulted in reducing the museum's capacity and limiting its staircase use. Following the consolidation works, we restored the glass roof and stained glass skylight over the stairwell, as well as the mural paintings. During the last restoration campaign, the main rooms of the house were decorated into their original setting and materials. Special attention was paid to wall paintings, fabric wall coverings, curtains, furnishing, light fittings, and even technical installations. Those works lasted over 10 years and were established, especially carried out in the bathroom, the petit salon, the winter garden, and in the kitchen area. Concerning the domestic area, it is important to mention that after we removed the former housekeeper's apartment, we revealed enough evidences to make the refurbishing of the original kitchen possible. Also, the small elevator, which connected the former housekeeper's living room with the bedrooms in the attic, was dismantled and a new staircase was built to the original model. Due to above-mentioned restorations, visitors can finally visit Hortas Museum and Studio, relishing the atmosphere and organization of both family and professional life. As a conclusion, to prepare a 20-year restoration project, a profound preliminary research is indispensable, as well as a global conservation plan within which different sub-projects can be defined and executed in phases. However, the success of a long-lasting building process also depends on the flexibility and the mutual confidence and respect of overall stakeholders and contractors. Therefore, I'm sincerely grateful to all team members who made of this project an exceptional learning experience. Our commissioner, of course, the president and the board of the Horta Museum, the heritage consultants and the Royal Commission of Monuments and Sites of the Brussels region, state subsidizers and the private sponsors, the many qualified craftsmen, the enthusiastic assistants and collaborators of my team and our technical advisors. But last but not least, my special thanks and appreciation goes to Françoise Aubry, inspiring curator of the museum, who was our most crucial partner during those long 20 years period of research and restoration. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you.